Founding member of WOW team is on it for 6 years, I think. So they will be reading our scripture this morning.
From Matthew 25, Jesus said, I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was homeless and you gave me a room. I was shivering and you gave me clothes. I was sick and you stopped to visit. I was in prison and you came to me. And his disciples said, Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry and feed you, thirsty and give you a drink? And when did we ever see you sick or in prison and come to you? Then the Lord said, I am telling the solemn truth. Whenever you did one of these things to someone overlooked or ignored, that was me. You did it to me.
Stay wide awake in prayer. Most of all, love each other as if your life depended on it. Love makes up for practically anything. Be quick to give a meal to the hungry, a bed to the homeless, cheerfully. Be generous with different things God gave you. Pass them around so all can get in on it. If words, let it be God's words. If help, let it be God's hearty help. That way, God's bright presence will be evident in everything through Jesus.
A prayer from Haiti. Lord, thank you that you have given us the name Christian and give us the strength to carry it.
We are going to sing together, beginning this sermon, and we're going to sing a song that is in a foreign language. You probably have done it here in English when you're marching in the light of God. We are going to sing it first in Zulu, and you may be thinking, why are we singing in Zulu when Kay went to Haiti and they speak Creole there? Well, I'm not going to tell you yet. I'm going to tell you later. So as Pastor Dave would say, I'll get back to that. Okay? So we are going to sing Siam together, and we're going to just do it a cappella. And so you'll just join me as you can pronounce Siyahamba Kukanein Kwekos. Okay, Siyahamba Kukanein Kwekos. Okay. Siyahamba Kukanein Kwekos. Siyahamba Kukanein Kwekos. Try it. Siyahamba Kukanein Kwekos. Siyahamba Kukanein Kwekos. Repeat it. Siyahamba. God is no stranger, and it is, of course, from Haiti. The prayers are written in Creole, but I am grateful that they have translated them into English. A lot of the prayers are very with practical, common imagery. It's wonderful. Some of them are quite humorous, and I'm going to read to you one of the funny ones because it spoke to me as I was preparing for the sermon. Lord, help us not to talk too much, because talking too much is like driving too fast. Sometimes the brakes are not good, and we pass by the place where we intended to stop. When we talk too much, we know we go beyond the truth. That is a prayer from Haiti. As most of you know, this last Thursday, January 12th, was the 2-year anniversary of that horrendous earthquake in Haiti. I've put in just a couple of photos up here as a reminder of the physical damage that took place and is still very prevalent. But we all know that the physical brokenness there, it only touches the surface. The difficult situation in Haiti continues to be mind-boggling. My trip there was one in a long line of responses to God's cry for help. The United Methodist Global Response, as well as from many other groups, was immediate. We developed quickly something called the Haiti Response Plan, and money started going to already existing Haitian Methodist ministries. The Methodist Church has been in Haiti for decades and decades, maybe even 100 years, a long time. Schools, health clinics, churches, small businesses, all have been supported by the Haiti Methodist Church, as well as the United Methodist Church in the United States and places from around the world. So after the earthquake, things were stepped up, and a lot of money has been sent, and many work teams have been sent. Adam Arnold, who's a member of our church here, he went a year ago on a work team. There, I went in October, and then we have another work team going in a few weeks. By now, there's been hundreds of teams from the Methodist Church, and millions of dollars gone to support them. Diane Visser, I asked her to tell me how much money that our church family, our little Bozeman United Methodist Church, has given to Haiti since the earthquake, and it's almost $25,000. $25,000 that you have given, and the depth of that is hundreds of people, from little children to our elders, pitching in to get almost $25,000. And then Diane tells me that an additional $16,000 has been given towards the UMVIM teams, the United Methodist Volunteers and Mission teams, to help in their preparation and their travel and in their work there, buying supplies for that work. And also, just so you know, that when we go on and work on a team, we take money with us that is the money to pay the Haitian workers there, because there's no boss hiring workers to build the church. So we bring their wages, and that's their wages, and that is their regular job. And each team, because there's team after team going to all the different places, support those workers there. Wow. Thank you for being so generous, because it is from you that those kind of ministries work. And speaking of wow, our wow kids had, within a week of the earthquake 2 years ago, some of us leaders looked at what they were going to be doing in January for outreach in our community. And we decided we would cross off the next week and put in Haiti help. And I look back at that, and what the kids did was they made these little boxes, if you can remember that, and they decorated them with pictures, and they gave them to some of the people who work in our church. Sharon Tudor Eisler took one to her workplace. Various people took them to places they own or places they work and put them on the counters. And the children's boxes collected within a couple of weeks over $1,000 that also got added on to the money that you give here in this congregation. It was a fabulous way for the kids to learn to respond quickly. So that that's one reason why I asked the children to be part of reading scripture this morning, so they are also part of this Hayes story. I'd like to make a side remark here that doesn't have to do with Haiti. I just wanted to mention that, remember, our response to God's cry or God's nudging can take many forms. It can have many faces and go down many different paths. Sometimes our response means going, like going to Haiti, like I did. But sometimes it means sending the other group, like you sent me, or we will be sending our team in February. But all of those responses, whether we're the goers or the senders, are done in love. That is the important part. It's a loving response. Jesus' words and the scripture that was read this morning are pretty clear, aren't they? I love Matthew 25. It's very clear. If there's somebody hungry, feed them. If there's somebody cold, give them something to wear. If there's somebody who's been in an earthquake, what do? We respond to their needs. It is clear that when we hear God's cry, we respond. That cry that we hear can come from our own families, here, our spouses, our children. It can come from our church family, responding to people who just had surgery. The cry can come from our local community, from people around our state, like the people in Sydney. It can come from nationally, around the country. It can come internationally. God is crying out for us to respond. One call is just as important as the other call. So it is up to us to listen. It is God who equips us each day to listen to how to respond here or there, how to love our neighbors in all of the different forms. The examples are huge. The WOW team, as I told you, they've been very dedicated to the people in Haiti. But a couple of weeks ago, they were at Gallatin County Rest Home, and they were singing and playing and coloring and visiting the elderly people. They are the most fragile people in our community, some of them very near death. And those children brought a great amount of joy to the people as they went into each room and sang and colored. So they understand that response to God's cry can be 1 mile that way, or it can be all the way to Haiti. Also, like Diane Burleson goes every week to the food bank. She works there as that volunteer and responding to the cry of people who are hungry. But how do you support that? You all bring food here to the church so Katie Doppenbaugh can drive it over to the food bank to support those people who are hungry. So we are all responding. It's in different ways. Our high school, middle school and high school kids, every year go on a mission trip. During the year, they also do mission outreach. But every summer, they take a week out of their summers to serve others. This last year, they were in Vancouver, Washington. What's Vancouver, Washington? Is that very famous? Is that, was there a big earthquake? No. There are homeless people there. And to expand their world and to understand that God is speaking to them here in their own families and also in unimportant, non-famous places. That is something that we need to learn to hear and respond to as well. So, my main focus this morning is telling you about one time of response, and that was my response to going to Haiti. This time, it happened to be me going, but next time it will be different. Someone else will go. So, 2 months ago, at the end of October, I joined 6 other people from our Yellowstone Conference of the United Methodist Churches in Montana and Wyoming, and we joined together with 9 more people from the Rocky Mountain Conference. That is Colorado and Utah, and those 16 people traveled to Haiti. But we were not alone in that response. People here gave us money to help support that trip.